on the mountain, in the valley, in the crowded streets, or the empty desert, in our hope, and in our waiting, we are never alone.
Everybody, who's happy to be here today? Give Jesus praise this morning. Hey, look, this is the time of year when we slow down just a little bit and spend time with our families, our loved ones, and some are, in-laws and some are outlaws, and we get that. We're going to experience some of that this season, but I don't want us to miss the fact that God is in this place and he's working in and through you. And you may not feel it. You may not feel it. In fact, most of the time, I don't even know that I can say that I feel it. But what I want to ask you to do today is to join God in what he's doing in this city, in this place, in this church, in the lives of our people. And I put these out on your seat. I actually had some volunteers, some students do this before service, and they laid them out in your chairs. Some of you may be sitting on them, so if you don't see one, maybe check under you. But I wanted to give you this. This is an invite to our church, and I want you to pray about maybe who you can share this with this week. We're going to continue to do stuff like that, leading into the Christmas season for sure, leading into Christmas Eve. We would love for you to invite someone to come sit with you. In fact, that's what it says. You're invited, come to church with me. And so just as the Lord, opens those doors, would you pray about that? Maybe who you could invite? A couple of weeks ago, I was hanging out with a good friend here at church, and he's a new believer, and we were just so happened to be at Target of all places, because that's what guys do, I guess. We go to Target, and it was there where, just standing in line, he had this sense of just asking the guy in front of him to come to church. And of course, I'm like, I don't like talking to people in public like this a lot, so I'm like that. And, I'll do it a lot sometimes, but I just let him kind of do it. Turns out he's from the same small town in Missouri that my friend is from. He's like, no way, that's crazy. I'll be there. I'll come to church. I don't know if he's here today or not, but anyway, all that to say, you never know what door God may be opening for you. And he's inviting us to join him where he's already moving. He's already moving the lives of people around you. And so I would love for you to pray about who you could invite Christmas Eve or even maybe next Sunday to join us here at the Living Stone. We believe God is doing great things. So we're in this series called God With Us. Obviously, as we enter into Christmas, as we talk about, as we sing about Jesus, the coming Messiah, the birth of Jesus, God himself in flesh in Jesus, the Son of God. He took on man's flesh. He left eternity with God, and he took on man's flesh to be with us. That word is called incarnation. He took on man's flesh. God himself, Jesus, came to be with us, to live a life with us, to die for us. And the best news ever is that he didn't stay dead. He was raised to life on the third day. That gives us hope. Hope that death is not the end, that our sins can be forgiven, and that God knows us. We don't have to pray to any other saint or even Mary. Mary's a great woman. She was a great godly woman. But a lot of people think, well, I need somebody that understands me as a human to go to. No, Jesus was that. The Bible says that he was tempted in every single way that we are, and yet he was without sin. That's the God we serve, the God that knows you intimately, the God that knows exactly what you're in right now, whatever season of life that is. He's been in your shoes. He's been tempted. He's been tempted to do crazy things, and yet he overcame, not only to show us the way, but to live a sinless life so that he could offer himself up for us. I want to take you to this theme verse for this series. It's in Matthew chapter 1. It says, look, Matthew writes this, look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which literally means God is with us. He's with us. Last week we talked about life in the valley. We talked about the seasons of life. Maybe you found yourself in the valley. And last week we talked about how we don't need to fear the valley, the valleys of life. Now, some of us are on the mountaintops, right? Like God is good and things are good in our life. And, you know, we're on the mountaintops. We're like on cloud nine with God. And then some of us are in the valley. And the valley is not a place to be scared or ashamed or anything like that. Because he's with us. We looked at that psalm in Psalm 23. David writes, the Lord is my shepherd. Right? Remember that psalm? He says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear any evil. Why? Because I know you're with me. I know you're with me. Even in the darkest valley. Why? Because there's a light. There's a shadow. There's a light being cast on that, whatever that is, that scary valley. But there's a shadow there. And the shadow tells us that there's light. And the light is God himself. He's with us in the darkest seasons of life. We can enjoy him on the mountaintops, but we really get to know him in the valleys. Now, some of us in this journey of life are maybe feeling like we're just in a wilderness. Have you ever felt that way before? Like maybe life is just dry. Maybe you're in a season of just spiritual dryness. It's like the Sahara or the Gobi Desert. There's no life. It seems in your life, it just seems like there's no spiritual movement in your life. There's nothing that lives in the desert. Maybe you feel like your life is like that at this point. And the wilderness is a metaphor in the Bible for trials and hardships and oftentimes wandering. But it's also interesting that the wilderness signifies a place where people specifically Jesus himself or even the prophets would retreat to, the wilderness, a place of desolation, a place maybe where they could experience God in a more intimate way. And so if you find yourself in the wilderness or in the valley, there's peace and there's hope. Maybe you're not sure what to do next. Maybe you feel like you're just stuck. Maybe you're feeling like you need to just stay in your current job or wrestling with loans, finances, or work-related stuff. And maybe you're always thinking there's got to be something better. But your life just feels like you're in the wilderness. Maybe you're in that season of life where you're thinking about, maybe I should buy a house. I'm tired of renting and throwing my money away. Just feels like I just can't get past this situation that I'm in. Maybe you're almost ready to just throw in the towel altogether and call it quits in this life. Now, I got to be honest with you. There is hope. It may feel like you're alone in the wilderness. It may feel like you have no hope in front of you. But I can promise you that you're not alone. The biggest thing that Satan wants in your life is to isolate you. The enemy wants to isolate you, make you feel like you're the only one that experiences this loneliness or this wilderness. That's just not true. God is with you. You got a room full of people here that want to love you. You got a staff that can love you. The wilderness often follows seasons of the mountaintops. You know what I mean? We used to call this the mountaintop of camp. You know, we'd come home from camp and it was like a camp high. It's like, man, this is great. Like, God is so good. Like, I'm just never going to sin again. Did you ever say that when you went to camp? Like, I came home saying, I'm just never going to sin again. I want to prove God so good, and I'm just never going to sin again. That lasted about 5 minutes. I'm a pastor, so maybe I should say a little bit longer. But the reality is, like, when I was a kid and I went to camp, I was like, man, I just want to live for Jesus. That mountaintop experience at camp was so good. But then life, as it does, tends to lead to the valley and maybe even to the wilderness. You know what? Jesus was baptized. And
by John the Baptist. And after he was baptized, he was on cloud nine. It was a religious mountaintop experience, to say the least. And the reason I say religious is because as followers of Jesus, we know that that is part of our walk with God. But in that moment, as he's baptized, this Holy Spirit descends on Jesus like a dove. And then we hear this booming voice from heaven. And it's God. And God says, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased." In other words, it's like God the Father is just saying, "This is my Son. I'm so proud of him. He's lived a sinless life. He lived a life that I could never live, that you could never live. He came to serve, not to be served. And he's asking us to join him in that journey." But right after this mountaintop experience, he goes into the wilderness for 40 days around Jericho. I've actually been to this area where they think Jesus was tempted by Satan himself. Satan tempts Jesus three different times. And every single time, Jesus overcomes those temptations by quoting scripture because it was in his heart. Now, you may go, "Well, he's God's son, so he should know the word." He was also fully God, but he's also fully man. So you got to understand that he has emotions. He's not just a pre-programmed demigod. He's not a robot. He is fully God and fully human. And yet when he was tempted, he overcame. But right after he was baptized, for a period of 40 days, he was tempted in the wilderness. And maybe you can relate with that. Maybe you've had a friend that's betrayed you, or maybe you hate your job, or you feel the financial pressure. Maybe you feel like you're hurting, you're confused, you're empty inside, and nobody can understand that. The big thought that I have this morning for you is this. The wilderness seasons in life give us the opportunity to depend on God completely. So the wilderness is not an accident. But these wilderness seasons that we're journeying through are there so that we're totally dependent upon God. My mind often goes to Billy Graham. I've mentioned this before, but when Billy Graham was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, he didn't just say, "Well, poor me, you know, I've lived a good life for you, God. Why did you give me this?" He didn't say that. You know what he said? He said, "I know God allowed me to go through this so that I'm totally dependent upon him." Man, what a perspective. I want that kind of perspective whenever I'm in the wilderness or when I'm in the valleys of life. I want to take you to this prophet named Elijah. He learned the principle really well. It's an Old Testament prophet. God used him in a very strong way, a massive way. He's literally on a mountaintop, Mount Carmel. And Elijah falls shortly after this mountaintop experience. He falls into this deep depression. He's desperate. He's depressed, even after seeing all the crazy things that God did through him and all the miracles that happened. He finds himself in the wilderness. And just to give you some background, there's a king at the time of the life of Elijah. His name is King Ahab. King Ahab was like the worst king that has ever lived. Like, he was so evil. And what's the old saying? Behind every good man, there's a good woman, right? Well, this is kind of the opposite. Behind every evil king like Ahab, there's an even more evil woman. Her name is Jezebel. And Jezebel was not a peach, if we can say it that way. She was in fact, you may have heard church people say in the past, "Well, she's got a Jezebel spirit." Well, this is Jezebel. It's not a compliment. If someone ever calls you a Jezebel, it's not a compliment, okay? Behind every evil king like Ahab is a Jezebel. So all that Elijah did on Mount Carmel, he was involved in killing prophets. Now, this sounds a little crazy. But what he did was, on Mount Carmel, he was competing. They were having this kind of like beatbox battle, like rap box. You know what I'm talking about? Like beatbox battle. Except it was like calling on their gods. And there were all these prophets, hundreds of prophets of Baal. And they were calling out to their gods saying, "Come, you know, show yourself, reveal yourself." And Elijah makes fun of them and says, "Maybe he's in the restroom." He's a hilarious guy. He's like, "Maybe he's busy. Maybe he's in the restroom." And then Elijah calls down fire from heaven, totally consumes the altar itself, this altar made of stone and all the water that was around it. After experiencing that, God wiped out the prophets that were there too. And Jezebel sends word to Elijah. She says, by this time tomorrow, I will kill you. Now, just to give you some background, King Ahab has been after Elijah for like 3 years now. And he's a little scared, but he gets really scared when this mad woman comes after him. Anybody? I'm going to ask you to raise hands. All the guys are like, okay, zoned in. Let me take you to this place. It's in 1 Kings chapter 19. It says, Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judea, he left his servant there. Now, this is about a 100-mile journey that he has just run. This is how afraid he is. He's just experienced all these crazy things that God has done in and through him. And then he runs for his life. While he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, he came to a broom bush, sat under it, and prayed that he might die. And listen to his words. After seeing all the crazy things that God did on the mountaintop, Elijah says this, I have had enough, Lord. Maybe you've said that. Maybe you've said it recently. There's been times in my life where I've said this. But isn't it interesting that just after Elijah experiences the mountaintop experience, he's in the wilderness and he says, I've had enough, Lord. Take my life from me. I'm no better than my ancestors. And maybe you feel that way. Maybe you've just had it up to here raising kids. Maybe you've got teenagers. Look, they're challenging. They're cute and they're little. They turn into teenagers and then someday they'll go off and you'll enjoy your life again. So I'm halfway kidding. This is a great season of life. Teenage years are a great season for you as a parent to be able to pour into your kids. Because you won't have them around forever. They're going to be gone soon. But maybe you've just recently just said, God, I've had it up to here with all the things that are being presented to me. And listen, some of you need to get your kids in church. And you are. Some of you are doing that. I'm so proud of you. I was thinking about this on the way to church this morning. The seasons of life where I felt the lowest, I can remember back to when I experienced God for the first time as a child. And was in church. And I had that foundation to see me through the hardest seasons of my life. The church is just a body of believers, but it's so much more than that. This is where we experience God. This is where we experience him on a deeper level. And maybe you're just saying, and my life is just crazy. I can't go through this any longer. Maybe you have a boss that's passive aggressive, narcissistic, or demanding, and you just can't take it anymore. You've had it up to here. Maybe you're just now getting back on your feet again financially, and then life happens. Something breaks. You got to repair it. Maybe you just had it up to here. Maybe you've made dinner for everybody, and they don't realize that you slaved hours over dinner, and they just leave the dishes. They eat it in 30 seconds, and they're gone. And you're saying, by this time tomorrow... Maybe you just said, I've had it up to here. You can handle a lot, but one thing pushes you over the edge. Now, let me just take you to Elijah's mindset. He stood down this evil king, Ahab. He prophesied a drought. He called for a drought as a result of Ahab pursuing him in his evil ways. For 3 years, the skies dried up. Elijah was a prophet. He was able to do that in his day. For 3 years, there was this drought that came over the land. And King Ahab was full force pursuing Elijah, like not holding back. And God protected Elijah. In fact, while he was hiding from King Ahab, he was fed by ravens, like literally crows came and brought him food. It was supernatural provision. In fact, Elijah even was a part of raising a young boy from the dead. God was doing a crazy work in and through him, and he experienced God in a way that few people on this planet ever will. He experienced God on the mountaintops. He saw all these things happen. In fact, this prophet stands down 850 false prophets and called down fire from heaven. And then God later destroyed the false prophets. And then Elijah asked God for rain finally. And he sees this cloud the size of a man's hand appear in the distance. And he had faith, knowing that God was answering his desires, his prayers. He has seen God move. He's been on the mountaintop. He's seen God's protection and provision. But this, all of these crazy things, all these things of experiencing God on the mountaintops was taken away when one angry woman comes at him. That's all it took to knock him off this high point with God. When you look at Elijah, he seems overwhelmed, he seems exhausted, he seems tired, he seems maybe what we would call in church like just spiritually depleted. Have you ever felt that way? I don't know if you can ever relate to this, but like preaching God's word often feels like a full day's work. Now, listen, the joke is, you know, do you only work one day a week? And I tell people, no, I work half a day a week, okay? Just half a Sunday, you know? But that's not true either. I want to put that out there. You know, we do work nonstop throughout the week. We really do. And we have fun, but we also meet a lot of people's needs and work with people and meet with people and meet with the city. And it's just a crazy, crazy, crazy thing that we're involved in. But after preaching a 30-minute sermon, It can actually, I just feel so drained sometimes. And it's not a physical drain, it's a spiritual drain. One pastor told me one time, it's probably because you're preaching against the forces of darkness. And I thought, there's probably something to that. I'm spiritually pouring out. I'm pouring myself out spiritually, physically, emotionally. And there's nothing like a good Sunday afternoon nap. I love Sunday afternoon naps because that's where I just get recharged and I eat some food at lunch. And for some of us, maybe that's what you need. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Think about that from a sheep's perspective. Even though Jesus is our shepherd and he's taken us down through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear any evil because I know you're with me. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He prepares a table of land before me in the presence of my enemies. He's got my back. I know he does. He restores my soul. God doesn't preach a sermon to Elijah. He doesn't rebuke Elijah. He doesn't say, where's your faith? God tells him to get up and eat and rest. In verse 5, it says, at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. He looked around and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then laid down again. Sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is take a nap. Amen? Man, I love naps. You ever had one of those naps where you wake up and your face is still in the shape of the pillow or you got creases on the... That's a good nap. Some of you have toddlers. They wake up, sweaty. And that's a good nap. But what does it mean to be still and to know God? To be still and know God. I love this passage. It's in Exodus 14:14. We have this in our house on several things. And it says, the Lord will fight for you. You just need to be still. You just need to be still. If you're in a wilderness season, just be still. Let the Lord fight for you. Let the Lord protect you. Let him provide for you. Let him show you just how faithful he is. Now, don't stay there, right? We don't just live to sleep. I mean, some of us do. Let's face it. Amen. That sounds like a lovely life. But we can't stay there. But it's okay to rest. Sometimes the most godly thing you can do, the most spiritual thing you can do is rest. And listen to this. A second time, the angel came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. So he got up and ate and drank, strengthened by that food. He traveled for 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. This is the mountaintop, which we also call Mount Sinai. This is where the people of God in a few generations past had been set free from Egypt. And this is where Moses and Aaron came to this mountain. And this is where God dwelt. He was literally descended upon the mountain in flames of furnace and black clouds of smoke. This is where the Ten Commandments were written by God's finger. This is the same mountain that he goes to. So after this mountaintop experience, he goes into the wilderness and he finds himself. He retreats to this mountain of God. He went into a cave, spent the night, and the word of the Lord came to him. says, what are you doing here? Elijah, what are you doing here? Have you ever heard God say that to you? Like, what are you doing? What are you doing here? Sometimes some of us have run from God. And if that's you and you're here this morning or you're watching online, I just want to tell you, sometimes God says, what are you doing here? This place isn't where I want you to be, both physically or spiritually. What are you doing here? It's not what I had for you. God is a loving Father. He wants the very best for you. But sometimes we find ourselves far from Him in the wilderness. What are you doing here? We serve a God of second chances. I'm grateful for that. Elijah didn't get it right the last time, so this is the second time, and the Lord is coming to you again, maybe even this morning, saying, what are you doing here? Let's get right. Come back to me. Come back to me. You're my child. I don't know if you've ever lost a child in a mall before, but the fear that comes over your heart as a parent is like unlike anything else. And that's how God feels when you're far from Him. He has that, not that He doesn't know where you are, but you've wandered away from Him spiritually. And He loves you. He wants you near Him. I love this passage, and probably even this next verse even more than all the others in this story, because I can relate to Elijah. He says, after God says, what are you doing here? What good is this going to do? And listen to this. He says, verse 10 says, he replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down their altars, and put up prophets. Put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. Elijah is complaining. And I promise you, you and I would probably be in the same boat here. I know I would be. How many times do I complain about my current situation? Whatever wilderness I'm in. And it's okay to complain to God. He can take it. He's big enough. In fact, you can just be real with Him. Just tell Him exactly how you feel. Tell Him you feel like you're empty. Tell Him you feel like He's far from you. Maybe even say, God, I don't even feel you, and I should be feeling you right here in church. Tell Him He can take it. He can take your complaints. Elijah's in a spiritual wilderness. He's hurting. His need is so great. He cannot see beyond his own need, which is right in front of him. And God meets Elijah in the wilderness. Please don't miss this. Listen to me. Look at this. God meets Elijah in the wilderness. You see, God in these days, all the gods in these days had a temple dedicated to them. You went to the temple to meet God. But our God is different. He meets us in the wilderness. Your deepest need becomes a gift when it drives you to depend on God completely. Verse 11 says, the Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by you. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. God was not in the wind, He wasn't in the earthquake, He wasn't in the fire. God wasn't in those incredible things. God was in the ordinary whisper. God was in the whisper. Why does He whisper? He whispers because He's close to you. He's that close. See, the enemy shouts lies, but God whispers the truth. And He wants you to experience Him in a relational way. Years ago, I went through a wilderness season. And I was honest with God and Told God, I don't feel like I know you. I don't feel like you understand what I'm going through. I was honest with him. I was complaining to him. And I found myself just like this in a season of deep depression. I isolated myself. I thought, who can understand what I'm going through? I'm a minister. I'm a pastor. Who could I go to that would actually listen and maybe even comfort me and show me a way back to the mountaintop? And I found myself in my truck up in the mountains after probably the lowest point that I've ever been in, feeling the same way, seeing the same thing that Elijah's saying. I thought, God, nobody understands. I don't expect you to understand either. I'm not here to try to get you there. I'm just saying, like, I was in this place. And maybe you're there too. And God slowly and gently whispered, I'm here. I've been faithful. We just sang that song, Faithful Through the Generations. God, you've been so faithful. My mind goes back to my childhood church when I first experienced Jesus and the grace of God, the love of God, the patience of God, the provision of God, the love of God. He's been faithful. God, help me out of that pit. He helped me out of that valley. He helped me out of that wilderness. And today, I am who I am today because of him. And he offers you a way to him. Listen, Psalm 34 says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. He's close. Sometimes he doesn't come in an earthquake, in the wind, or in the fire. He comes with a still, small voice. Be still. Let him speak to you. He's close. We read this last week, and I'll close with this. Psalm 139 reminds us that he's with us. It says, where can I go from your spirit? God, where can I go from your spirit? God, you are everywhere. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. Your right hand, that's the hand of blessing in Scripture. You know why it's the right hand? It's because you're his child. He loves you. He cares deeply for you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. We know that. We have that promise. And for some of you, you're here this morning, you've never experienced God in that way. You've never experienced God that close to you. And listen, God's not here to judge you. He's not here to make you feel guilty. He's not here to make you goody-two-shoes. No, he wants you to know him. He wants you to really know him. And this morning, I want to offer you this chance. If you're here in the room today and you want to know who God really is, the God of the Bible loves you, that he cares for you, he's close to you, he'll never leave you, he'll never forsake you no matter what comes your way. If you want that peace, if you want that kind of relationship with the living God, I want to encourage you to just, in this next few moments, to pray this simple prayer with me. With every head bowed, every eye closed in the room, I want to encourage you to pray this simple prayer with me. You know, for far too long, maybe you felt like you are trying to do life on your own and you just don't know where to go and you don't know how to get out of maybe a situation that you're in. But the Bible tells us that God is near to the brokenhearted, and maybe that's you right now. The Bible tells us that Jesus came to be with us, took on man's flesh, to be with us, to live a life alongside people. He lived a sinless life. He died for you. Please hear me say that. He gave his life for you. The Bible says that even though we were still sinners, even though we were still enemies of God, Jesus willingly gave up his life for you. That's a kind of love
that nobody on this planet has except for God, that God loved you so much that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him and confesses with their mouth would be saved. That's what the Bible says. It's that simple. You just pray a simple prayer. You believe in your heart. You confess your need for him. And you can be saved. You can have a relationship with him. You can go to heaven when you die. If you're here and you're ready for that moment, I want to lead you in this simple prayer. Just be honest with God. Say, God, I know that I need you. God, I want to know you. Tell him that. Say, God, I believe you love me. God, I believe that Jesus loved me, that Jesus died on the cross for me. Now, would you be honest with God and just say, God, please forgive me of all my sin, all the sins that I've ever done. You can be washed clean of all that right here, right now. Say, God, please forgive me of all my sins. Tell him you believe and thank him. Say, thank you. If you just prayed that prayer, you have God with you and he'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. If you just prayed that prayer with no one else looking around, would you raise your hand? If you just prayed that prayer for the first time, every head still bowed, every eye still closed, would you just look up here at me if you just prayed that prayer and raise your hand where I can see it? And if I missed your hand, would you please come see me after church? God, we're so grateful, God, that you'll never leave us. You'll never forsake us. God, we don't deserve it, but you love us. God, help us honor you today through the rest of the week, through the rest of this year. As we sing this last song, God, I pray that our hearts would be reflective of all that you've done for us. We love you. We thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and worship.